and welcome everyone to this class on FMG revision for orthopedics. I hope you guys are able to see me and hear me well. My name is Dr. Janvi. I'm the anesthesia educator on An Academy, and this is a part of a series in which we are going to be revising short subjects within 1 week. So for all of you who are new for this, we have already covered revision of skin and anesthesia. And today we are going to be revising orthopedics, and tomorrow we are going to be revising radiology and psychiatry. If you all are not aware of the links for all of these classes, please do let me know. They are available on Telegram and I will be happy to share it with you guys. So beginning today's class, this is our Telegram channel. This is where I'll be sharing all the links of the classes, so you can join me here. The plus subscription on An Academy will help you get access to live and recorded classes. You can learn from India's top educators and you can access our question bank with 25,000 plus questions. The Iconic subscription is a partnership between An Academy and PrepLadder, which will help you get the live lectures of An Academy and the video lectures of PrepLadder. And these are our special class features. Like you can see on the right hand side of your desktop, there is a raise a hand option. So if you raise your hand, you can ask me any doubt that you have live. This is our question bank with 25,000 plus questions. Then these are all our NEET PG toppers, and these are the batches that we have right now: the clinical case discussions and instruments batch, the target NEET PG 2022 batch, and the target next integrated 2023 batch. And this is my code, Dr. Janvi Live. If you guys would like to join me on An Academy on the plus subscription, you can use this code and get a 10% off on your subscription. All right. So beginning with today's class, this is the first question that I have for you guys. So this mode of healing of a fracture is called as tension band wiring. What are the two important bones that you will fix by tension band wiring? So what do you do in tension band wiring? You basically put the wiring in a figure of eight manner, correct? So whenever you have a fracture, the distraction forces are taking the two parts of the bone away from each other. So by putting the wire in a figure of eight manner, you are making the distraction force into compression forces. So the question that they ask in the exam is, what are the bones in which you do tension band wiring? So patella is one, very good Linga. What is the other bone in which we do tension band wiring? Another bone in which we do tension band wiring other than patella? Come on guys, I'm waiting for your answers. Anything in the upper limb where we use tension band wiring? Okay, it is olecranon process. Okay, just remember, olecranon process of the ulna is the other place where we use tension band wiring. Many a times they ask you this in the exam. They will give you the image or the x-ray with the, so suppose this is the patella, there will be a break in the patella, and if you see, the x-ray will show a figure of eight wiring like this. Okay, so you should be able to identify what is the bone. So only two places we use, patella and olecranon process. Now what is the name of this instrument that is used? Okay, and when is it used? So I will tell you when it is used. Tell me, what is the name of this instrument? So this person has an open injury, open fracture, open injury, in which the bone and the soft tissue, everything is exposed to the environment outside. As a result of it, this wound may be infected. So instead of putting an implant in the bone, instead of fixing the tibia with an implant, you just want to keep it in place. This is the fractured bone. So instead of putting an implant inside and infecting the implant, what are you planning to do? You're just planning to hold the broken parts of the bone together till the infection goes away. What is this called? Yes, very good. This is called as an external fixator. Okay. And which external fixator is this? This is Elizarov's external fixator. What is the use of external fixator, anyone? So external fixator is specifically used whenever you have an open or a comminuted injury and you don't want to put any kind of foreign implant inside to fix the bone. Okay, because if you put a foreign implant in an open wound, it can get infected. So instead of putting this foreign implant, you will just hold the broken parts of the bone together with the Elizaros fixator, and later on, whenever the chances of infection go away, you will put the implant inside. Okay, all right. So this is your Salter-Harris classification of fractures. Now, this is the mnemonic for Salter-Harris classification. So I will draw a fracture, and I want you guys to tell me which classification of Salter-Harris is it. Okay, so there is a separated growth plate, and there is a fracture line extending from the growth plate to the epiphysis and to the metaphysis. So what is this Salter-Harris classification? Yes, very good. This is Salter-Harris classification 4. Okay, now another question that let me ask you: if this is just a separated growth plate, so in this case, just a separated growth plate, what is the Salter-Harris classification? Class 3. Yes. So I have discussed this multiple times before with you, how to remember the Salter-Harris classification. So just remember it from the mnemonic Salter. So S means separated growth plate. So this is class 1. A is fracture line going above the growth plate. L is fracture line going lower to the growth plate. T is fracture line going through and through the growth plate. And E is erasure of the complete growth plate. So this is a comminuted fracture. Okay. All right. Next, you need to know is complications of fractures and how to identify it. So tell me, what is the complication in this case? What is this deformity called as, and it is seen in which fracture? So you can see over here, the carrying angle of the elbow is increased and it looks like a gun. So what is this called? Gun stock deformity. Very good. So gun stock deformity is seen as a complication of which fracture? Yes, gun stock deformity is a complication of fracture, supracondylar fracture humerus. Okay, it is malunion of the supracondylar fracture humerus. All right, now this is your next one. So tell me, what is this deformity called, and in which fracture do you see this malunion? Yes, absolutely correct. This is called as dinner fork deformity. Okay, so what is happening over here? There is dorsal displacement of the broken part of the radius, correct? So it is looking like a dinner fork deformity, and it is seen in Coley's fracture, correct? Okay, now in Smith's fracture, what is the name of the deformity? I have a picture of it over here. This is in Smith's fracture. In Smith's fracture, there is a ventral displacement of the broken part of the radius. Yes, very good. It looks like a garden spade. What is a garden spade? The thing with which you pick up the soil in the garden, that is called as your garden spade. Okay, so this is called as your garden spade deformity. So this is all very important, because they give images of this. This has been asked in the last 3 years of the FMG paper in orthopedics, because these are very similar and common things that happen in orthopedics. So these gun stock deformity, dinner fork deformity, and garden spade deformity, you should know all of these happen in which fractures. Okay, now next thing that I want you guys to tell me is compartment syndrome. So this is one of the complications of compartment syndrome, and it is called as Volkmann's ischemic contracture. Can you tell me this happens in which fracture? In which fracture do you get Volkmann's ischemic contracture? Yes, absolutely correct. So you will see Volkmann's ischemic contracture in fracture supracondylar of the humerus. Okay. So in this, what do you see? You will see that because of the cutoff of blood supply to the hand, the entire elbow gets flexed, the forearm gets pronated, and the wrist gets flexed like this. Okay, and the hand of the patient will remain like this forever. So that contracture deformity is a permanent deformity. All right. Okay. Now, next thing I want you guys to tell me is about fat embolism syndrome. So in which fracture do we see fat embolism syndrome? I'm asking you direct questions from the exam. I'm not going to sit and teach you the entire topic. I'm directly asking you the questions asked in the exam. Yes. You most commonly see femur causing fat embolism syndrome. Now, how will they give a clinical picture of fat embolism syndrome? Suppose this is your femur and there is a break in the femur. Okay, so at that time, whatever are the blood vessels that are present around the femur, the fat that is present in this area will enter into the blood vessels from the broken part. Okay, so from the marrow cavity, the fat will enter into the blood vessels. From there, it will be carried to the lungs. Okay, so when it is carried to the lungs, the blood vessels that are supplying the lungs, they will be filled with fat. As a result of this, the patient will start presenting with decreased perfusion to the lungs. So the patient will start presenting with desaturation and petechiae that are present. And this fat can also go to the brain and it can cause some neurologic reactions. So the patient can also start getting seizures. Okay, so this is how the patient will present, because the fat is going to small capillaries all over the body. Okay, so this is exactly how fat embolism syndrome question will be given, and they will ask what is the most commonly bone fracture. So the most commonly bone fracture causing fat embolism is fracture of the femur. Okay, all right. Now, next thing that they will ask you in the exam is name the vertebra involved in these fractures. So there are cervical vertebrae involved in all of these fractures, and they love to keep asking these questions. So Jefferson's fracture is because of fracture of what? C1 or C2? Yes, so Jefferson's fracture is seen in fracture of C1. Okay. Hangman's fracture? Yes. What is hangman's fracture, anyone? Okay, whenever you give death sentence to someone, at that time, have you seen them hanging the person, death sentence mein? When they hang, phasi dete hai jabhi. So at that time, what happens is that they tighten the noose around the neck, correct? They tighten that rope around the neck. So when they tighten the rope around the neck, it hits over here at C2 vertebra and it causes fracture of the C2 vertebra. So when the C2 vertebra gets fractured, it goes and it compresses against the spinal cord, and that causes death. Okay. All right. Undertaker's fracture is fracture of which vertebra? C6 to C7. Absolutely correct. So when does Undertaker's fracture happen? Is this a anti-mortem or a post-mortem injury? Does it happen when the patient is living, or does it happen when the patient is dead? Undertaker's fracture. Okay, this is a post-mortem fracture. Just remember this. Okay, now what happens whenever someone dies, then the person who is carrying the dead body into the ambulance vehicle and then to the cemetery is called as the, or to the Shamshan Ghat, that person is called as the undertaker. Okay, so after the person is dead, now undertakers don't handle the body very well. Sometimes they will not support the neck. So usually when you're alive, you can support your own neck, okay, and prevent it from falling. But after death, if this neck is not handled properly, the entire neck will go behind like that, and there will be fracture of C6 to C7. So that is called as undertaker's fracture, and that happens, it is a post-mortem fracture, it happens after the death of the person. Okay, then clay shoveler's fracture. Fracture of what vertebra? It's only fracture of C7. This is the one that they ask very commonly, because this is seen after weightlifting. Okay, after lifting heavy weights, this is one of the fractures that you get. And your chance fracture or seatbelt injury. When you are driving in a car and you have your seatbelt attached, and suddenly you stop the car. Okay, so if you stop the car, suddenly brakes are there. Your body will move ahead and then back. So because of that, you get seatbelt injury. The seatbelt hits against the vertebral column, and you get a fracture of the thoracolumbar spine. So this is T12 to L2 fracture. Okay. So these are the named fractures that they keep asking again and again in the exam. So this one slide will help you remember all the named fractures for the exam. All right. Okay. Now, next very important topic is pod spine. So what is pod spine, and the important questions asked about it? What is pod spine? What disease is it? Yes, it is TB of the spine. Correct. Okay. So what is the most common site of bone and joint TB in the entire body? Which bone is most commonly affected by TB? Hip. No. It is the spine only. That's why we are studying, no, pod spine. Okay, so the spine is the most common site where you get involvement of TB in the bones, amongst the bones. Amongst the entire organs, it is the lungs. But if you're talking about the bones, then in the bones, spine is the most common part. Okay, what are the most commonly involved segments in pod spine? Most commonly involved segments in pod spine. It's not lumbar spine. Yes, absolutely correct, Insam. So it is lower thoracic and lumbar. Okay, so it is the end, like T10, T11, T12 and L1, L2. Okay, so this area, this is the one where you have the most commonly involved segments in pod spine. Okay, is this pod spine primary or secondary? Are you getting the bacteria directly into the spinal, directly into the spine, or are you getting it from somewhere else? Secondary, very good. So where is the primary source of it? Most common primary source from where the disease is arising. Yes. So it comes from the lungs or the liver or the gastrointestinal tract. So it can be TB of the intestine, TB of the lungs, TB of the liver, and that will be carried by the hematogenous route back into the epidural veins, and from there you can get it in the spine. Okay, what is the most common organism involved? I don't think anyone would not know this. It is Mycobacterium tuberculae. And what is the most common route of spread? That I've already taught you, it is hematogenous. Okay, so now there are four types of destruction of the vertebra whenever you have pod spine: paradiscal, central, anterior, and posterior. So this is what you need to know. So look at the presentation. So this is paradiscal. Okay, so the disease will spread like this along the discs, sides of the disc. This is central type. So center of the vertebral body will be involved in this. This is the anterior type. So anterior to the vertebral body, you will have the abscess. And this is the posterior type, in which you will have the abscess in the spinous processes. Okay. Now, out of all four of them, what is the most common type of involvement of the abscess of pod spine? Yes, absolutely correct. Your paradiscal type is the most common one that is involved. Okay. Now, all of them usually spread through venous spread, arterial spread and venous spread. Okay. Now, tell me, next question, what is the least common site of TB in bone and joints? If I have asked you about most common site is fine, what is the least common site of TB in bone and joints? Which is the bone which is the least involved in TB? Very good, Insam. So it is the mandible. Okay, so your temporomandibular joint is what is the least common site of TB, bone and joints. Okay, all right. What is the most common symptom of pod spine? Backache. Very good. So the patient is going to get backache because of destruction of the vertebral bodies and formation of the abscess, which presses on the spinal cord. Okay, what is the first clinical sign in case of pod spine? Ankle clonus is not the first clinical sign. It is back stiffness of the back. Okay, now why is there stiffness of the back in case of pod spine? Anyone? Not tenderness also. Why is there stiffness of the back? Because there is a abscess. Okay, that abscess causes inflammation, and that inflammation causes muscle spasm of the paraspinal muscles. Okay, so there is paraspinal muscle spasm causing back stiffness. Okay, all right. Now, what is gibbous, what is kyphus, and what is cold abscess? Anyone? If one vertebra is involved, okay, now you know that what happens over here, whenever you have Mycobacterium tuberculae reaching over here, what will they do? They will start breaking down this vertebra. And because of destruction of this vertebra, there will be formation of an abscess, correct? So when one vertebra is involved and you see destruction of one vertebra, what is it called? When two vertebra are destroyed, what is the swelling called as? And when three vertebra or more are involved, then what is the swelling called as? So have a look at this. Here you can see only one vertebra is destroyed, correct? So what is this swelling called as? Here you can see two vertebra are destroyed. So what is the swelling called as? Okay, So when one vertebra is destroyed, this swelling is called as a knuckle. Okay, so this swelling that you will be able to see over here outside will be called as a knuckle. Okay, if two vertebra are involved, then that swelling is called as a gibbous. And if three vertebra or more are involved, then the swelling is called as a kyphus. Okay, so when they say na kyphosis, that means that more than three vertebra are destroyed by TB. All right, understood? Knuckle, gibbous, and kyphus. Okay. What is the investigation of choice for pod spine? MRI spine, very good. Now, in MRI spine, what is the earliest specific sign that you see? This is one question that they ask many times in the exam. Yes, absolutely correct. So, there will be reduction in paravertebral space. Okay, because of destruction of the vertebra, there is reduction in paravertebral space. Okay, and what is this type of TB? Now tell me, you know the types of TB, correct? You have central type, anterior type, posterior type, and paradiscal type. So if the abscess is going from the sides like this, what type is this? Absolutely correct. This is your paradiscal type of TB. Correct? This is paradiscal type. And what is this arrangement called as? Whenever you see this presence of the abscess, what do you call it? It's forming a globular swelling over here. What is this called? Anyone? Okay, have you seen the nest of a bird? So the nest of a bird looks something like this. Okay, so the nest of the bird looks like this. So this is called as bird's nest appearance, or it is also called as a globular appearance. Okay, all right. Or it is also called as a fusiform appearance. Okay. What is the treatment in this case? Manish, reduction in intervertebral disc is the earliest specific sign in any kind of radiology. You will be able to see it in X-ray also. You will be able to see it in MRI also. What is the treatment? Yes, the treatment is anti-Cox treatment or anti-tubercular treatment. Okay, so everything about pod spine done. How does it appear? What is the involvement? What is the vertebra involvement? What are the symptoms? What is the radiological findings? Now the last term is, what is spina ventosa? If they ask you what is spina ventosa in the exam. Yes, absolutely correct. If you have TB of the digits, if you have TB coming to these bones, then that is called as spina ventosa. Okay. And what is the most common type out of central, anterior, posterior, and paradiscal to end up causing POTS? Paraplegia. Central type. No. Okay. So imagine POTS paraplegia is what? Basically, you will have destruction of the vertebra, and then this entire thing forms a like this over here. Can you see? I'll just show you. So, can you see the vertebral bodies are completely destroyed over here, and they will slowly start forming a swelling, and there will be inflammation all around this. So, because of this, the cord that is there over here, spinal cord, that will get compressed. And all the spinal nerve roots also that are coming out from here will get compressed. So because of compression over the spinal cord, the patient will lose the sensory and the motor innervation to the legs. Okay, so the patient will become paraplegic. He will not be able to walk. Why? This area has all the thoracolumbar spinal nerves which supply the legs for walking, for feeling the sensations of the lower limb, for bowel bladder sensation. So because of the compression of the spinal cord, all those sensations will go away and the patient will become paraplegic. So that is called as POTS paraplegia. Okay. So out of central, anterior, posterior, and paradiscal type, the paradiscal type is the most common one to cause POTS paraplegia. Okay. And what is concertina collapse? Anyone? What is concertina collapse? Okay. So what happens is, if you have continuously this vertebra, this vertebra, this vertebra, all of them have central type of TB. Okay, so this vertebra is destroyed from here, this vertebra is destroyed, this vertebra is destroyed, all the vertebra will fall down like a concertina. What is concertina? That musical instrument jo aisa band baja type hota hai na, you compress like jack in the box, you compress and it open it up, compress and open it up, that is called as your concertina. Okay, so concertina collapse is seen in that case. All right, so in central type of TB, because of destruction of the vertebra, you will get a concertina collapse. All right, now what is the most common site of Pott's paraplegia? Pressure on which site is most common whenever you have Pott's paraplegia? Okay, no, pressure on the upper thoracic spine is most commonly seen whenever you have Pott's paraplegia. Okay, so you will have pressure on the T4 to T9 vertebra causing Pott's paraplegia. Now you say that Pott's paraplegia is early if it is happening in less than 2 years of the disease onset, and you call it late when it happens after 2 years of the disease onset. Now this you should be able, what is the earliest sign of Pott's paraplegia? Earliest sign of Pott's paraplegia, how will you know that maybe the patient is becoming paraplegic? Not stiffness, back stiffness is the earliest sign of normal Pott's spine, TB spine. Earliest sign of Pott's paraplegia, this is a complication, the legs are not able to move because of the swelling. No, you will be able to see ankle clonus. Okay, ankle clonus. So this is a what type of lesion? Upper motor neuron or lower motor neuron? This is an upper motor neuron type of a lesion, due to which you will see presence of ankle clonus and spasticity in the legs. Okay, all right. So in Pott's paraplegia, initially you will start having that ankle clonus and motor involvement. Okay, so the patient will not be able to walk properly. He will require support for walking. After motor involvement, you start getting sensory involvement. So he will stop being able to feel the ground, bowel bladder disturbances will start happening. Okay, and after this you start having, this will be less than 5% of this place, and then after this you start having both motor and sensory involvement along with flaccid paralysis. Okay, so initially till here you were having upper motor neuron involvement, now you have lower motor neuron involvement, due to which you have flaccid paralysis. Okay, now what will they ask you in the exam? In the exam they will simply ask you, what is the first sign that you see in Pott's paraplegia? Okay, so you just have to answer this, ankle clonus is the earliest sign that you see in Pott's paraplegia. Okay, all right. Okay, now let's move on to a little bit about the metabolic bone disorder. So osteogenesis imperfecta, what is the other name of this disease? Breakbone disease. Okay, one more name, it is also called as marble bone, sorry, not marble bone disease. What is marble bone disease? It is also called as brittle bone disease. Okay, all right. In osteogenesis imperfecta, what is happening? Basically, all your bones can easily break. They are very fragile. Why are the bones fragile? What is lacking in osteogenesis imperfecta due to which the bones are fragile? Yes, osteopetrosis is marble bone disease. So osteogenesis imperfecta is called as, yes, so because of collagen type 1 defect, you are getting very, very weak bones and the bones can break easily. Okay, what is the inheritance in this disease and osteogenesis imperfecta? Is it autosomal recessive, autosomal dominant, X-linked disorder? What is it? Yes, the type of inheritance is autosomal dominant. What are the symptoms of the patient? Very specific symptoms that they will give you in the exam. First thing will be, easily he'll come with multiple fractures. What are the specific things that you see in the eye and in the ear? Yes, multiple fractures, bone pain. In the eye, the patient will have blue sclera. Okay, this is very specific for this disease, presence of blue sclera, because I have absence of type 1 collagen. And what do you see in the ear? You see hearing loss because of otosclerosis. Okay, all right. Now, what do you see on x-ray? So on x-ray you will see many bones are having fracture, and those all fractures are in different stages of healing. Some fractures have healed, some are old, some are fresh fractures. So all the time the patient will keep having fractures. Okay, then what is the management in case of osteogenesis imperfecta? So you give them braces to prevent further deformity. So like a body brace, like a thoracic brace, so that the movement is not too much. Even if they cause a little extra twisting or movement, it can lead to breakdown of the bones. Okay, second is osteotomy to realign the broken bones, and B is bisphosphonates, which will strengthen the bones. Okay, so you can remember it like BOB. In osteogenesis imperfecta, treatment is BOB. The differential diagnosis is battered baby syndrome or Caffey syndrome. What is battered baby syndrome or Caffey syndrome, anyone? Yes, very good, Tari. So it is nothing but child abuse. Okay, so whenever a child is beaten up by his parents, multiple bones may you will see fracture. So the parents will hold the child, they will throw the child, they will hit the child. So the child will be having multiple fractures in many different places. Okay, so that is called as battered baby syndrome. So here also you will have multiple fractures, and in case of osteogenesis imperfecta also you will have multiple fractures. Okay, all right. Okay, next metabolic bone disorder that we have to discuss is osteopetrosis. What is the other name of osteopetrosis? We just did that. Yes, it is also called as the marble bone disease. Very good. Okay, so what happens in osteopetrosis is you have thick deposits. There are basically two types of cells in the bone. You have osteoblasts. Osteoblasts, B means they build the bone. Okay, and you have osteoclasts. C means they cut the bone. Okay, so in this case, your osteoblastic activity is normal. So bone building is normal, but your osteoclastic activity is reduced. So bone cutting is reduced. So what happens? The bone keeps building on top of the normal bone. Okay, so you have very thick, dense, sclerotic bone because of problem in the osteoclastic activity. Okay, now how do you diagnose this disease, anyone? So on x-ray of the long bones, this is all that you see. So what is the name of this sign? The first sign that you're seeing over here, this bone looks like a flask that you use in the laboratory. So this name of this flask is Erlenmeyer flask. So this is called as Erlenmeyer flask deformity. Okay, and in the vertebra you will see window within a window. So what is this called as, this appearance? You can see dense sclerotic bone and the window. Yes, this is called as picture frame appearance, or it is also called as endobones appearance. Endobones means bone within a bone appearance. Okay, all right. Now, this is also one of the appearances of osteopetrosis. What is this called as? Both of these. This one over here is called as rugger jersey spine. Very good. Because it looks like this jersey in which you have alternate black and white. And what is this one over here called as? This is called as champagne glass deformity. Okay, what is the treatment of osteopetrosis, anyone? Can you do something to reverse this disease? It is one of the genetic disorders. Can you do something to reverse it? You can't do anything to reverse it other than doing a bone marrow transplant. Okay, so the treatment in this case is a bone marrow transplant. Yes, absolutely correct, amnesic. Champagne glass deformity is also seen in achondroplasia. So whenever you get this kind of question, you have to go through the clinical signs and symptoms and then mark the answer. Okay, all right. Next one that we have is osteoporosis. So in osteoporosis, you have decreased amount of bone. So basically, your osteoporosis is mostly seen in old women. Okay, so in them calcium vitamin D deposition is not taking, so your bone formation is not very good in that case. Okay, and your osteoclastic bone resorption is way more as compared to osteoblastic bone deposition. So you have nothing but weak bones in case of osteoporosis. Correct. So one question that they ask is, what is the most common metabolic bone disease? So your osteoporosis is the most common metabolic bone disease out of all of them, out of osteogenesis imperfecta, osteopetrosis, the most common is osteoporosis. Okay, now what is the most common risk factor in case of osteoporosis? Anyone? Definitely many people in your family must be having osteoporosis, especially females. So the most common risk factor, in fact, no, it is not old age, it is menopause. Yes, absolutely correct. Reduction in estrogen during menopause is the most common risk factor. What is the most common complication of osteoporosis? Yes, postmenopausal women get it the most. Most common complication is multiple fractures. Out of that, Colles fracture in the upper limb and neck of femur fracture in the lower limb. These are the common fractures that happen in these patients. Okay, so Colles fracture, they'll usually come with a fall on outstretched hand in the history. And neck of femur fracture may, they will usually have a history of falling in the bathroom and then getting a fracture. Okay, what is the most common symptom in this case in osteoporosis? Yes, very good. They get a lot of back pain. And why does that back pain happen? Why is the back pain happening? Because of vertebral compression. Okay, so the vertebra are also bones, they are also very weak, so they start collapsing onto each other because of the weak bones. Okay, so because of the vertebral compression, you have a lot of back pain, and they start compressing the spinal nerves also, causing leg pain, radiculopathy. Okay, what is the most common site of back pain? I think everyone knows this. So it is your lower back pain. All women walk like this, dard ho raha hai karke. Okay, what is the most common site of fracture in this case? So that I've already told you, Colles fracture, neck of femur fracture, and even vertebra is commonly fractured. Okay, yes, Colles fracture is the most common fracture in the elderly, Colles and neck of femur both. Okay, yes, what are you seeing in case of osteoporosis? So you, I told you the vertebra start collapsing onto each other. So can you see, it looks like the vertebra are kissing each other, or it looks like the mouth of a fish. Okay, so on x-ray it looks like fish mouth spine. What is the investigation of choice in this case? Yes, it can also be called as codfish vertebra. If you draw like this over here, you can even make it look like a fish. Okay, so it can also be called as codfish vertebra appearance in osteoporosis. What is the investigation of choice to identify osteoporosis? DEXA scan. Very good. Okay, has any one of you all ever heard of this DEXA scan? What do I check in DEXA scan? Yes, so what is the full form of DEXA scan? They can ask you, they can give you this full form, and then they'll ask you what is the full form. So it is dual energy x-ray absorptiometry. Dual energy x-ray absorptiometry. Okay, so in DEXA scan, what are you checking? You're checking nothing but the bone mineral density. How well is the bone mineralized? Okay, so you give a score called as the T score in that case. Okay, now your normal T score that you see in normal people will be between 0 to minus 1. In osteoporosis, the T score will be minus 2.5. Okay, less than minus 2.5. That means the bone mineral density of these patients is 2.5 times away from the standard deviation of normal. Okay, standard deviation is 2.5 times away from normal. All right. Okay, what is the management of osteoporosis? What are the special drugs that we give in that case? Bisphosphonates, very good. Bisphosphonates are the drug of choice. Anything else? Calcium and vitamin D supplementation, very good. Okay, Now, someone told me this is happening because of low estrogen levels, correct? So, can I give something to increase the estrogen levels? So, Tariq, what is it called, the drug that I give? Yes, very good. SERM. SERM is the drug that I give, selective estrogen receptor modulator. Okay, give me an example of SERM that is used for osteoporosis. It is raloxifene. Okay, raloxifene. Okay, what is helping as something which will help in building the bone and also reducing the cutting of the bone? Something which is an anti-resorptive plus a bone builder. Okay, anti-resorptive may teriparatide, both may you have strontium. Okay, so these are all the things that are used for the treatment of osteoporosis. Okay. All right, now last one that we have is osteomalacia. Osteomalacia is nothing but rickets in older adults. So what is the deficiency in case of osteomalacia? What is deficient? Calcium, yeah, very good. And more importantly than calcium, the deficiency is in vitamin D. Okay, so obviously the management will be by giving calcium and vitamin D supplementation. Now, can you tell me why would a person have decreased calcium? Any two reasons why a person would have decreased calcium? Yes, very good. Either the person has reduced intake of calcium, or there is reduced GI absorption of calcium, or there is increased renal losses of calcium. Okay, so these are the three reasons why there should be low calcium levels in the body. Okay, now, for osteoporosis, they will give you a kind of presentation in which they will say that there is a 55-year-old female. She was bathing in the bathroom. She fell and she got neck of femur fracture. Her DEXA scan shows a T score of -3.5. Identify the disease. So you will know it is osteoporosis. But in case of osteomalacia, what is the kind of features that they will give? So they will tell you there is a young female. This is seen mostly in people who diet a lot. So they don't get adequate nutrition, or people who are very, very poor. So they don't have adequate nutrition. So they are the ones who will present with these kind of symptoms. So there will be a young female and she'll present with multiple pain in the joints. Nowadays, even because of work from home, people who are inside for a long period of time, do not have much sun exposure, they get vitamin D deficiency. Okay, so they will present with young females who have arthralgia and muscular weakness. Okay, and again, like in osteoporosis, you had back pain because the vertebra was commonly affected. In osteomalacia, what do you have the most common thing that is affected? In osteomalacia, what is most commonly affected? Again, the spine is most commonly affected. Okay, so here also the most common pain that you will have is back pain. So if any of you all are having back pain, don't just leave it like that only. Chhod do, bhool jao, aise hi ho raha hoga, thoda late jayenge to theek ho jayega. There are many deficiencies in the body that can cause back pain. So always get it checked. Okay, all right. Now, how do I diagnose osteomalacia? What should I check in the lab? Yes, very good. So if I check my calcium levels, it will be low. If I check my phosphate levels, it will be low. Because the bone is breaking down a lot, I will have increased alkaline phosphatase levels. And I will also have low vitamin D levels. Okay. On the X-ray, what do I see in case of osteomalacia? There are three things that I see in the X-ray. Three specific things. Treatment, all of us know, we'll give calcium and vitamin D supplementation. The three specific things seen on X-ray, anyone? Identifying this. Cupping splaying is seen in rickets. It's not seen in osteomalacia. Osteomalacia is in adult rickets. Triangular pelvis, very good, Saurabh. So that triangular pelvis is also called as triradiate pelvis. Okay. Then this is this something which is called dash zones. So you will see radiolucency over here at the sites of compression. So you can see site of compression. You are seeing radiolucency at site of compression. Very good, Dr. Tariq. So that is called as loser zone. Loser zones. Okay. And in the spine, what do you see? Just like this previous one that I had shown you over here, fish mouth spine. You will be able to see fish mouth spine in osteomalacia also. Okay. So loser zone, fish mouth spine, and triradiate pelvis. These are the three specific things that you see in case of osteomalacia. Clear? Okay. Next. So this is the fracture of the patella. Okay. So these are the different types of fracture of the patella you have. Can you see the fracture line is straight over here, but the bone pieces are fine. So this one is undisplaced. Then you have transverse fracture. Then you have lower pole or upper pole fracture. Then after that you have multi-fragmented undisplaced fracture, multi-fragmented displaced fracture, vertical fracture, osteochondral fracture. Now, what is the treatment of fracture of the patella? Why am I showing you the slide again? I showed you in the beginning actually, but they ask this very commonly. So I want you guys to be able to identify this in the exam. So you should know what tension band wiring looks like. Okay. So can you see this figure of eight wiring that has been done? Here you can see the lower end of the femur over here and you can see the upper end of the tibia, but you can't see the patella. So to see the patella, what should I do? I need to take a lateral x-ray. So only if I take the lateral x-ray, I will be able to see the patella in the front. Okay. But how will you identify it in the exam? In the exam, if you see this figure of eight thing that is present, just try to identify whether it is upper limb or lower limb bones. If it looks like a big bone like this, like femur and tibia, that means it is fracture of patella. If it looks like small bones, humerus, radius and ulna, then it is fracture of the olecranon process. Okay. Or now, suppose you have this tension band wiring mainly works for these fractures, for undisplaced fracture, transverse fracture, lower pole or upper pole fracture. But suppose you have this kind of a fracture, multi-fragmented displaced. Can I actually do tension band wiring in this case? Will it be any useful for me or not? Will tension band wiring be useful? No, it will not be useful in that case. Okay. So the most common type is undisplaced fracture. This one. Undisplaced fracture is the most common type. Okay. No. So in that case, when I have this broken, completely broken fracture, what will I do? I will remove the entire patella. So that is called as a total patellectomy. Okay. Suppose I have SA fracture, vertical fracture. This is a very small piece and I'm not able to put it together. Now this one is still okay. It is a big piece. Suppose the fracture line was over here. Itna sa tukda chala gaya hai. And I cannot just put it together. So what will I do in that case? I can remove that part. So that is called as a partial patellectomy and you preserve the largest piece. Okay. So fracture patella, first choice is always to do a tension band wiring. Gold standard. Second thing that I'll do is partial patellectomy. And last, if I'm not able to salvage the patella, if it's broken down like this, I will do a total patellectomy. Okay. All right. Now moving on to the tumors in in orthopedics. So what is the most common bone malignancy overall? Is it a primary bone malignancy or is it a secondary bone malignancy? Does it arise in the bone or does it come from somewhere else as metastasis? Yes, very good. So mostly in the bones, you don't have tumors arising on their own. They mostly are metastasis from other parts of the body. And what are the most common primary areas in that case from where you get metastasis to the bone? Okay, if I'm talking about the spine mainly gets mets from where? Spine get mets from breast and lung. Okay, yes. So mets mainly comes from breast, lung, prostate, these three areas. Okay. Okay. What is, if I'm talking about a primary bone malignancy, it's arising in the bone. So which is the most common primary bone malignancy, which is benign? And which is the most common primary bone malignancy, which is malignant? Osteochondroma, very good. Osteochondroma is the most common benign primary bone malignancy. And what is the most common yes, absolutely correct. Malignant melanoma is the most common malignant primary bone malignancy. Okay. Sorry, multiple myeloma, not malignant melanoma. Sorry, my. Now we will go to one of the very, very common bone tumors, that is osteosarcoma. They love asking about osteosarcoma and these two appearances that keep coming in the exam. Every 2-3 years they will ask this, okay? Either the sunburst appearance or you will have the Codman's triangle appearance, okay? So let's talk about osteosarcoma. It is the most radio resistant bone tumor. So there is no point giving radiotherapy in this case. Radiotherapy is useless because of the fact that radiation does not penetrate through the bone and treat the tumor in this case. What is the most common bone involved in osteosarcoma? Most common bone involved? Yes, distal end of femur is the most common bone involved. Okay, what is the most common age group for osteosarcoma? 10 to 20 years of age, no? It is in 15 to 25 years of age, just age of adolescence. Okay, so they will give you a case scenario in which they will say there is an adolescent boy who is coming with pain in the lower end of the knee. Okay, so sorry, lower end of the thigh or in the knee, and there is a swelling that is there. It is not tender and it is not warm. If it was tender and warm, then what would it be? Suppose the knee swelling that you see, just above the knee, the swelling is tender and warm. So what would we be talking about? Very good, osteomyelitis, okay? But here in this case, it is mostly non-osteomyelitic, that is, it is a tumor, okay? What is the most common presenting feature? I told you, it is pain and swelling. Then just remember this, this is the most common radiation induced tumor, and you have two very specific features over here that is called as the Codman's triangle, and this is Codman's triangle and the sunburst appearance, okay? So can you tell me what is happening in Codman's triangle, anyone? And what is happening in sunburst appearance? Yes, the periosteal reaction is seen in which case? Okay, what happens is that the tumor cells, they start producing many inflammatory markers. Okay, so because of the inflammatory markers, you will have this entire area as the tumor cells grow, this entire area that is just below the periosteum, it gets lifted. Okay, so this is called as a periosteal reaction or periosteal elevation, which is seen in case of Codman's triangle. And what is sunburst appearance? Your sharpest fibers of the bones, they go to the periphery, okay? So they look like the sun is coming out. So this is called as sunburst appearance, okay? All right. So these two things, you just need to remember the names. You don't need to remember the exact things of sunburst appearance and Codman's triangle. Only this much is enough, okay? What are the other investigations other than X-ray, which will help you identify osteosarcoma? CT, no, not CT scan, it is MRI. Okay, now osteosarcoma most commonly will go where? What is the most common site of metastasis in osteosarcoma? Very good, lungs. And if my tumor is radiation resistant, if it will not respond to radiation, then what is the treatment, best treatment for it? Very good. So surgery is the best treatment, but before surgery, you give something called as neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Can anyone tell me what is neoadjuvant chemotherapy? How is it different from normal chemotherapy? How is neoadjuvant chemotherapy? Yeah, so neoadjuvant chemotherapy you give before surgery. So the size of the tumor will shrink and then you take the patient for surgery so that it becomes easier to operate. Okay. And then you will do a surgery. What is the surgery that we do in this case? Any idea in osteosarcoma? It is nothing but a knee replacement. Okay, so it is called as total knee replacement. So suppose your tumor is over here. Okay, this is your end of the femur and this is your tibia. So what will they do? This entire tumor ka part, they will remove it. They will cut it out. Now, what happens over here? Your end of the femur is lost. So they will put a prosthesis over here. Aisa. And here also, they will break a little part of the tibia and they will put a prosthesis and they will form a new joint completely. So this is called as total knee replacement. Okay. Now, there are some different types of osteosarcoma variants which you should know of. So one is periosteal osteosarcoma. That OGS is nothing but osteogenic sarcoma. Okay, so your periosteal osteogenic sarcoma arises from the outer layer of the periosteum. And then you have another type of osteosarcoma that arises from the inner layer of the periosteum. What is that called as? Which is the one that arises from the inner layer of the periosteum? Any idea? Okay. Your periosteal osteogenic sarcoma arises from the inner layer of the periosteum. Okay. All right. Now this, the rest of the tumors, your Ewing, sarcoma, osteomyelitis, all of this we will do in the next class. So I will see you in the next class at 8:15 p.m. So just a small 15-minute break. After that, we'll also be doing osteoarthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, all of those things. Okay. So let's see each other in 15 minutes. If you have any doubts, you can come back after 15 minutes and ask me. Tomorrow, guys, we will be doing radiology. And in radiology revision, what am I doing is I'm going to put together all the x-rays, CT scans, USG and the questions that have been asked previously for FMG students. It will be on the special class platform only. So you guys can use that PDF later for your benefit. Okay. So we'll be doing that for radiology tomorrow. Any specific timings you want tomorrow, because practically I'm free the entire day. So do you guys prefer it in the evening or in the afternoon or in the morning? Morning, what time? सेवन ओ क्लॉक इन द मॉर्निंग वन डे संडे तो मुझे लेट उठने दो. ओके मॉर्निंग 11 ओ क्लॉक इज ओके फॉर एवरीवन. आई विल बी हैविंग वन क्लास एट 11 एंड व्हेन शुड आई हैव द नेक्स्ट क्लास? 1 ओ क्लॉक इज 1 ओ क्लॉक ओके फॉर द नेक्स्ट क्लास? ओके सो वी हैव वन क्लास एट 11 ओ क्लॉक एंड वन क्लास एट 1 ओ क्लॉक. डू यू गाइस हैव एनी प्लस क्लासेस टुमारो? No plus classes tomorrow, correct? Okay. So I can keep one class in the evening also then, if no plus classes tomorrow. One class about twins. My OBGY is not very good. So unfortunately, I can't. Okay. All right, guys. Go take your well-deserved 15-minute break and then we'll try to finish the rest of the orthopedics after that. All right? Okay. Bye-bye. Any doubts that you guys have, you can ask me right now and then we can end the class. There are actually 1.5 minutes remaining for the class. So I can answer any doubts that you guys have or any requests that you all have for classes specifically. Nothing? PDF, you will get it at the end of the class. So once I end the class, you will get an option of downloading the PDF with or without annotations. Okay. So you can choose the one which says with annotations and you will get the written PDF. Amnishik is asking, are you taking classes for all subjects? I'm taking classes on special classes I'm taking for short subjects, and for medicine I'm taking on YouTube. Okay, so that's all the subjects that I'm taking classes for. OBGY rapid revision, unfortunately I can't, Preeti, because I'm not very good at it. I would have tried to, but I've really forgotten all my OBGY from MBBS, so I'll need time to read it and take it. I don't think I'll just be able to do a good job in that case. All right. Okay. Thank you so much, and I shall see you guys in 15 minutes. Bye bye.